morning and welcome to worship at the Monroe Congregational Church for Sunday, March 29th. It is the fifth week of Lent. We are following the CDC's guidelines around social distancing. So today's worship service was done by individuals in parts and later edited together. I want to especially thank Don and Kate Parker Brigard, who have helped me gather and have taken the pieces of what individuals have offered in their homes and edited them together for us all to be grounded and prayerful this morning. Please join us if you can at 10:30 for a Zoom coffee hour. A link should have been sent to you in the weekly email. As we are creating content for further worship services, I want to invite you to think about recording a snippet for worship on video from your home. You might read our scripture for the day, offer a greeting, a musical piece, lead a prayer, or our church's covenant. We are also accepting pictures, so please send them along. Be in touch with me or Kate Parker Brigard if you can help. Many of you have asked about our tag sale, which we have postponed until May 16th. So if you've been stuck at home, maybe you've had time to go through your gently used stuff for our outreach sale, and I want to say thank you. We've learned that the Monroe Food Pantry is in critical need of some supplies. If there's anything that you are able to drop off, remember that they have collection containers outside, and it's really easy to drop and go. You'll find a list at the end of the bulletin. The mission of our church is as important today as it ever was. Our receiver, John O'Rourke, would like me to remind you that you can mail or drop off your donations and pledges to the church office mailbox to the attention of our MCC receiver. Mail is gathered every day, and a deposit is made once or twice a week. You can arrange for electronic payments to the church via your bank, or you can make electronic payments via Vanco by clicking on the donate link on our church's website, www.mcc-ucc/donate.html. So last week, we began our time together with a good old-fashioned camp song, and this week, I thought we might try another one. It's a song that is special to me for many reasons. First, I learned it at Silver Lake Conference Center, our church camp. But it also incorporates some movement, and movement is good for the bodies that God gave us. So I want to encourage you to stand up and join me in singing, Leaning on the Everlasting Arms. It goes a little something like this. What a fellowship, what a joy divine, leaning on the everlasting arms. What a blessedness, what a peace is mine, leaning on the everlasting arms. Now's the fun part. Leaning, leaning, safe and secure from all alarms. Leaning, leaning, leaning on the everlasting arms. What have I to dread? What have I to fear? Leaning on the everlasting arms, I have blessed peace with my Lord so near. Leaning on the everlasting arms, leaning, leaning, safe and secure from all alarms. Leaning, leaning, leaning on the everlasting arms. Friends, let us pray. Join me if you will. Compassionate God, the wind of your spirit is the very sign of life for all who long for you. One breath from you and we are rescued from the arid valley of dry bones, given muscles and sinews and joy with which to praise you and be filled with the holy hope you grant to all your faithful children. Let our whole lives be filled with the life breath of the Spirit, that what has lain dormant may burst into bloom, and what looks to us to be death at first glance may be revealed as but sleep before the emergence of new life. Amen. Friends, who we are as a faith community is proclaimed by those gathered each Sunday through the words of our covenant. So I invite you to say it together with me, appreciating each phrase as the gift that it is. We declare our faith in God the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. In holy covenant, we bind ourselves to God and each other, becoming devoted disciples and active apostles. We promise each other to be faithful in worship and in support of this church, whose Savior and Lord is Jesus Christ. In Christian love, we will care for and support each other. With the Bible as our guide, we willingly promise all that we are and all that we have to the fulfillment of God's kingdom. Freely we say these things, glorying in the joy of our salvation. Friends, while we are all worshiping independently from our homes today, let us take a moment to remember how our community is grounded in the peace of Christ. Peace be with you.
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 May the peace of Christ be with you.
Invite the youngest members of our church to join me up here in front. But I hope that if you are at home and you are one of our church's kids and you're watching, that you can still help me out from where you are. I have some pictures that I'd like to show you. And when I show you the picture, I want you to tell me if you think that the thing that is in the picture is new or is it old. Okay, first picture I have, it's a fence. What do you think? New or old? Yep. Right. How could you tell that it's old? Well, it's kind of worn out, kind of falling apart, right? Okay, I've got one other picture here. This is a picture of a building. How can you tell if this building is new or old? Well, I guess all that protective netting that's keeping the bricks from falling off it might suggest that, yeah, it's old too. It's kind of falling apart. Finally, how about this picture right here? Yeah, that's an old shoe, isn't it? Yep, it's old. It's falling apart. Now, you obviously know that things fall apart. But in today's scripture story, we're going to hear that one of Jesus' disciples forgot. That disciple, he was pretty excited about how great of a building the temple was. And Jesus told his disciple not to get too excited about it, because at some point, even the temple would fall apart. Now, Jesus didn't say this to be mean. Jesus knew if the disciple only focused on the things that fall apart, like buildings, shoes, fences, and if most of those things started to fall apart at the same time, then life could start to get pretty scary and even confusing. Which is why Jesus was teaching his disciples to pay attention to the one thing that doesn't ever fall apart. That thing is God. Because then, while things do fall apart, this disciple would be paying attention to God's wisdom, and that would help the disciple know the best thing to do for himself, for others. And the same thing that Jesus was teaching that disciple in today's gospel story is true for us today. When things fall apart, Jesus reminds us that God is always with us, always wanting to help us know what to do for ourselves and for others. And that's the good news for today. Let's share a repeat after me prayer. Dear God, thank you for Jesus, who reminds us that in a world where things don't last forever, you are always with us. Thank you, God. Amen.
If I could tell the world just one thing, it would be we're all okay. Not to worry, because worry is wasteful and useless in times like these. My head. will get down on my knees. I will pray. I will get down on my knees. I will pray. I will get down on my knees.
This morning in our prayers of our community, we remember Cliff C. and his family on the loss of his mother this past week. We pray for Liz S.'s mom, for recovery, comfort. For Michelle M.'s mom, for healing and peace. For Clark's father, Armand, on the loss of his wife, Cynthia, this week. For Wanda, on her recent cancer diagnosis. We hold these and others in our hearts as we take a moment now for silent prayer. Holy One, God with us, we praise you with every word we speak. And with every moment we fall silent. You hear our prayers and sustain us along with all living things. You forgive our sins and bring us close to live in the goodness of your holy presence. We pray for everyone who longs for your joy, for those who are sick or in pain from morning till night, for those whose grief weighs them down, for those who are on the front lines of meeting humanity's need, for those who hunger and thirst for guidance, righteousness, medicine, or food. Rain down your love once again, O God. Soften our hearts so our lives can bear your fruit. Crown us with your goodness and let everything we do overflow with blessings for your people. We pray in the name of the one who brings us joy, Jesus the Christ, who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Good morning, everybody. I hope this video finds you well. Even though we are not all together this morning, I want you to know that God is always with you no matter what. Our scripture reading for today comes from the Gospel of Mark. If you would like to follow along, it is chapter 13, verses 1 through 8, and 24 through 37. Here begins the reading. As he came out of the temple, one of his disciples said to him, Look, teacher, what large stones and what large buildings. Then Jesus asked him, Do you see these great buildings? Not one stone will be left here upon another. All will be thrown down. When he was sitting on the Mount of Olives opposite of the temple, Peter, James, John, and Andrew asked him privately, "Tell us, when will this be? And what will be the sign that all these things are about to be accomplished?" Then Jesus began to say to them, "Beware that no one leads you astray. Many will come in my name and say, 'I am he,' and they will lead many astray. When you hear of wars and rumors of wars, do not be alarmed. This must take place, but the end is still to come. For nation will rise against nation, and kingdom against kingdom. There will be earthquakes in various places. There will be famines. This is but the beginning of the birth pages. But in those days, after that suffering, the sun will be darkened, and the moon will not give its light, and the stars will be falling from heaven, and the powers in the heavens will be shaken. Then they will see the Son of Man coming in clouds with great power and glory. Then he will be sent out the angels and gather the elect from the four winds, from the ends of the earth to the ends that are in heaven. From the fig tree, learn its lesson. As soon as its branch becomes tender and puts forth its leaves, you know that summer is near. So also, when you see these taking place, you know that he is near, at his very gates. Truly, I tell you, this generation will not pass away until all these things have taken place. Heaven and earth will pass away, but my words will not pass away. But about that day or hour, no one knows, neither the angels in heaven nor the Son, but only the Father. Beware, keep alert, for you do not know when the times will come. It is like a man going on a journey when he leaves and puts his slaves in charge, each with his work, commands the doorkeeper to be on watch. Therefore, keep awake, for you do not know when the master of the house will come, in the evening or at midnight or at cockcrow or at dawn. Or else he might find you asleep when he comes suddenly. And what I say to you, what I say to all, keep awake. The word of the Lord, thanks to be God. Here ends the reading.
Thank you, Kate. I wonder if you remember this scene. It's about a half an hour into the first Matrix movie. The hero of the story, of course, is Neo, played by Keanu Reeves. And in the movie, Neo's quiet, ordinary life is interrupted. It's interrupted because he's captured by some secret agents who work for the Matrix. The Matrix, that's a computer programming system that basically controls the world. It keeps it in line. A character known as Trinity saves Neo and brings him to Morpheus, a leader of the resistance movement. And Morpheus is played by the great Lawrence Fishburne. Morpheus, you see, he believes that Neo is the one who can save them from all of the oppression of the established system known as the Matrix. Morpheus meets Neo, and in that meeting, he offers him a choice of two pills, a blue one or a red one. If Neo takes the blue pill, then the story ends there. Neo will wake up from his bed in the morning with no memory of the kidnapping or what he's learned about the Matrix. He can return to his ordinary, predictable computer programmer life. If Neo chooses the red pill, then he will, like Alice, continue to tumble down the rabbit hole towards this strange new world. He'll have a chance to understand and to see the Matrix for himself. Morpheus seals the deal by telling him, quote, "All that I'm offering you is the truth, nothing more." Blue pill, forget everything. Red pill, know about it all. Now, of course, our hero Neo takes the red pill. Reading this Markan apocalypse this week, for me anyway, maybe you too, it feels a little bit like we've swallowed the red pill. The term apocalypse comes from the Greek, apokalyptein, which means to uncover or reveal something that's normally hidden. It's like pulling back the veil or a curtain so that we can all see the world as it really is. And so I wonder, beloved, what have you seen this week? I hope that what has been uncovered for you, your eyes, I hope your eyes have seen kindness and integrity and grace and selflessness. Maybe that hasn't been the case for you, and you have another list of choice words you'd like to describe to me right now. And I tell you, I won't judge. Because you know, when you think about it, we're not the first human beings to live through challenging times. Whether we're thinking about those early disciples worried about Rome destroying their society, like in today's scripture reading, or if I'm remembering my great-grandparents who lived through the Depression in the earlier part of the last century, it brings me some comfort to remember that humanity is connected through our trauma. In times like way back then and today, we come to find out that we truly are one. So about 200 years or so before Jesus was born, the Jewish people lived under the rule of Antiochus IV, a Syrian king. During his reign, a rivalry emerged within a major priestly family of Jerusalem. And as the story is told, a young man named Jason bribed the king to take his brother's place as high priest. Once installed, Jason began to remake Jerusalem in the form of a Greek city in order to earn the king's favor. The suppression of local culture was a form of control over the land of Judea. Antiochus, you see, he believed in the Hellenization of all of his holdings, ultimately becoming more Greek and less Jewish, provided an easier stepping stone for all of them to nearby Egypt, which Antiochus also hoped to conquer someday. So part of High Priest Jason's job was to establish who was a citizen and who was not, who had aristocratic privileges and who did not. He even built a Greek-style gymnasium for the formation of young male leaders that he could train in his own image. And Jason didn't just have King Antiochus's support in this, but he also had the backing of the wealthy ruling class as well. Acting like Greeks gave them better access to the wider world, better trading with foreign neighbors, and recognition from other nations too. So downplaying their Jewish culture in favor of the Greek made as much economic and political sense for them as it did their king. But then along comes this guy named Menelaus. And Menelaus wants to become the high priest himself, even though he doesn't come from a priestly family. So he promises Antiochus a hefty bribe. The king takes the bait, and he kicks Jason out of the temple. But it turns out that Menelaus didn't actually have the money he promised in his bribe, but now that he's high priest, he does have full access to the temple treasury. So he steals from it. Jason and his people, once they learn about the theft, are understandably upset. Hellenization was good, but taking from the treasury, that was going too far. Jason goes to war against Menelaus, but King Antiochus takes the attack personally and slaughters Jason's people. Then Antiochus and Menelaus go get some more cash from the temple. These thefts were massive desecrations, but Menelaus and Antiochus, they really don't care. In fact, they go further. They remove Judaism as the religion of the temple. They replace it with a blend of religions featuring the pantheon of Greek gods. Everyone is then required to practice this new hybrid religion, If anyone showed signs of being exclusively Jewish, like undergoing circumcision or owning a copy of the Torah, they would be tried and put to death. As a result, Jerusalem, for a moment anyway, lost its very identity. The Torah was no longer the law of the land. The entire cultural and political and religious system of the temple and the holy city had been displaced. For the faithful, everything in their world was upended. But the people found a way to come together under the leadership of the Maccabees, and they made things right again. This historical era came to be known as the Abomination of Desolation. The Jewish people remember it today as the Miracle of Light, Hanukkah. Fast forward about 140 years now to Jesus's lifetime, and his people are no longer under the yoke of Syrian occupation, but rather Roman. History, as we know, has a way of repeating itself, maybe because we aren't really great at learning the lessons. Again, the political and religious elite are in cahoots with their overlords. Again, for Jesus and his followers, the temple leadership has been corrupted. So what will happen? How will they maintain their identity in the face of this new, yet all too familiar threat? And how will those who feel threatened respond to Jesus's active acts of love? They already know the answer. Jesus isn't trying to scare the disciples and his other followers for the sake of just scaring them. He isn't using threats of destruction of the temple to coerce the people into following him. That's not the kind of leader he was. Jesus was just reminding them of what they already knew about what happens when we face destruction and loss. And their job, he tells them, is to act with integrity always, even in the face of great fear and suffering. But he also offers them some hope. He promises that their long walk in the wilderness will soon be over. Even the fig tree's tiny, tender sprouts are breaking out in the middle of chaos. Can you see it? New life is being born. And what will that look like? We all know people who have gone through tremendous trials, difficult, hard things. People who, after having that experience, have become bitter and angry. And we know of others. Others who, looking back, were able to see the grace and have used their trials and tribulations to become even more generous and kind. Your challenge, my friends, this week is to look for grace. Find ways in which God is shaping each one of us right now. Keep watch. Look for how God is working out new ways of being community, new ways of being church, new ways of being in this world, birthing new life in you. Next week, our service will begin with a celebration of Jesus' entry into Jerusalem. It's still Palm Sunday, but it's going to look a little different than it has for us before, because we cannot physically be together. I know that in my heart, and in the heart of many of you, this is a deep and tender grief. In the end, we will prepare to walk onward with him to Golgotha, where the cross awaits. That cross stands for everything that we still need to be saved from. Our casual brutality, the ease with which we deny the humanity of others, the pain of hating and being hated. Jesus offered his people hope that at last the sacred and the profane would merge as one, and all pain and horror would cease. Easter is coming. Resurrection is on its way. And we are bearers of that hope still. Not because of Jesus' apocalyptic predictions, but because of Christ's universal creative presence. It isn't the destruction that gives us comfort, but Easter morning's affirmation of life. So, as we confront once again our yearning for Jesus' better way, stay awake. Be vigilant in your devotion. All has been revealed, and with our help, all can be relieved. And as you carry yourself and others through this week, remember that everything will be well in the end. And if it's not yet well, then friends, it's not yet the end. God bless you. Amen. Benediction that I offer you at the end of our service is about how we are to go out into the world. Well, this week, the benediction is about how to stay in. Stay in touch with your pastor and your fellow church members who might need you. Stay in the loop on the needs in your local community and other parts of our world. Stay in prayer, that the realm of God may be established in our hearts and minds. Stay in the path of the Holy Spirit, which brings fresh winds and new ways to practice our faith. And finally, beloved, stay in the love of Christ Jesus. Amen.
I see trees of green, red roses too. I see them bloom for me and you, and I think too. myself. What a wonderful world. I see skies of blue and clouds of white, the bright blessed day, the dark sacred night, and I think to myself, what a wonderful world. Colors of the rainbow, so pretty in the sky, are also on the faces of peoples going by. I see friends shaking hands, saying, how do you do? They're really saying, babies cry.